Well, it's certainly a joy to be back at Clearbrook Baptist Church. I do appreciate your pastor, his friendship, his love for the Lord Jesus. And I was his RA, but he really did not give me any trouble. And RA just means a resident assistant, meaning just kind of a leader over the dorm. And I don't know what the leadership of the school was thinking whenever they selected me for that, but it's all right. We're all privileged to make mistakes and all that sort of thing. But I enjoyed his spirit, his attitude, his demeanor, his position, and his disposition towards God's Word, God's people, and I thank God for it. I want to just say a few things here before we get into the message. I will be starting in John chapter 3 there, John chapter number 3, in just a moment. Give you just a brief update. Where we're at, we're thankful for God's leading in our life.
Amen.
God's love, His leading is perfect if we'll allow Him to lead. We just, if we'll get out of the way and allow God to prompt us, He has perfect divine appointments for us all throughout life. And I'm thankful for God's grace. It's all sufficient. In a born and raised in Jumping Branch, West Virginia, the stickweeds, and I thank God for West Virginia. It's wild while you're there. It's wonderful every time you leave. And it's great to get back. I love the mountains. I've been in some of those places that are so flat you can watch your dog run away for 3 days. And so it's good to be in the mountains. I thank God for that. But God did call my wife and I October 18th, 2011 to go to the United Kingdom. We were there. It's a very interesting place. Some of you may have been there before. I'm not sure. It's a rapidly changing place. It's just radically secular. Man is worshipped all over the place. Heavy taxes. I think it's a very interesting place. The history there is amazing, what God has done in that country in the past, what He's doing right now, and how the Gospels went from that small, tiny island all throughout the world. God likes to do amazing things through places that just does not, you wouldn't expect that. Can any good thing come from Nazareth? And they were talking about the Lord Jesus. And Jesus, you know, came from there. Some people say, well, he started in Bethlehem. No, He was really in heaven before Bethlehem. Bethlehem, that was Jesus coming for us. And while He was here, He died for us. And then when He rose again and to ascend to the Father, He's interceding for us. And so Jesus' work has been from eternity past to eternity future. And I believe we understand and know that. But to England, we started out an hour south of London in a city called Brighton. Has anybody ever heard of Brighton before? Some of you probably have heard about it from a movie. My wife knows. I don't know what the name of it is, but some little girl said, let's go to Brighton, and it kind of made Brighton famous. But anyhow, Brighton is the homosexual capital of the United Kingdom. The United Kingdom is made up of England, Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland. Several million people. London is home to approximately 7 million people, depending on how many Syrian refugees or refugees they're ushering into the country. It really gets packed on the island. But we're an hour south of London in Brighton, home to about 270,000 people, a very international city. If you walk down the main street through the city of Brighton, you would hear a number of different languages. It was almost rare to hear English person speak as you walk down Queen's Road from the train station there in Brighton. Lots of Asian people from Spain, Italy, Brazil, Lithuania, just all over the place, Iraq, Iran. And so you'd walk down the street and hear all these different languages. And sometimes I would look at that and I think, well, this is overwhelming. You know, how do you reach these people? And you obviously reach them with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, embrace them with the love of God, show them that God is full of grace and truth, and that God loves them, and Jesus Christ died for their sin, was buried, rose again, He's alive forevermore. It's not just some ancient Victorian thing that our ancestor talked about, but He is alive and well, and He loves you personally.
Amen.
And so it's exciting to share that message. It's not always easy. I got scared. I got overwhelmed working in a city that's full of homosexuals. We live in Mayberry. you live in Mayberry. You say, oh, I'm in Roanoke. You don't understand. People, there's gangs. People die and murder, rape, all that sort of thing. If I could load you up on an Airbus 377, whatever it is, and fly you to Gatwick Airport, get off the plane, walk over to the train station, get on a train and take a 45-minute ride from Gatwick Airport to Brighton, and walk you around that city on a Saturday night for about 2 hours, you would wake up tomorrow morning and want to get back on the airplane, fly back over here, and kiss the ground when you got here. I could share things with you tonight that would give you nightmares. I could share things with you that my wife and I have seen, you would say, you need to be quiet. That's so immoral. You can't share that. Well, there's young people here. It's very, very wicked. Just vile, wretched. You think, how can the depravity of man go so low? It would blow your mind. We didn't come back because it was a difficult place and that the gospel would not work. We came back because I believe God wanted us to go and see something and preach the gospel and see where Christians back here in America, what we're headed for here in America. You see, it's going to be too late when we finally wake up. My wife and I are in a different church almost every week, and the just how apathetic, lukewarm, just the casualty among Christians. It's sickening. I'm not here to beat anybody up. I hope I preach an encouraging message here tonight. But when you live in that society, in that realm, and that group of just evangelistic atheists and people that just live in such hatred towards God, and you think, man, the opportunity that Americans have, and we, I include myself, we're squandering it.
That's right.
We're wasting it. In June in Brighton, they have a completely naked, head-to-toe, completely naked bicycle ride through the city. It's not just 200 or 300 people. It's 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 people that ride through the city. People are lined up from one end of the city as they ride all the way through. And you would think, little children are not there, but they're there. They have a pride parade in Brighton. It's one of the largest ones that I know of. I don't do the research and all that sort of thing, but it's very, very large. People come from all around the world to come to that pride parade, and homosexuality is just elevated as it's a god. And somebody would say, how do you minister to people like that? Well, they're living in unbelief. You lived in unbelief. I lived in unbelief. How did you come out of that unbelief? How did you go from living in darkness and depravity, being dead in your trespasses of sin, and living in such iniquity and immorality and idolatry, to come out of that darkness into the glorious light of the gospel? How did you come there? The truth.
Amen.
So the only way to confront homosexuality, all these symptoms, is with the truth. Because I know a lot of born-again believers who will attack the symptoms and not go to the root of the matter.
That's good. That's right.
You know, we're good at dealing with symptoms.
You're right, brother.
We're really good at that.
Right.
I'm accused of that. I've done that. But when I read God's Word and I find Jesus coming to a well, Jacob's well. By the way, Jacob's well didn't just pop up a few weeks before he got there.
Amen.
Jacob dug that well back in Genesis, several thousand years before Christ. And he dug a well. And you think about all the people that came to that well. See, Jacob, when he dug that well, he wasn't just living for the here and now. He'd done something that was lasting, that was beyond his life.
Right.
In John chapter 4, we read that Jesus came and he sat on that well.
That's right.
I find from that I want to live a life in such a way that it has an impact on other people's life when I'm dead and gone. And God finds the peace, the grace to be able to come by and just sit on it and bless it just a little bit.
Good.
And so that's this mentality of us attacking symptoms. Jesus, when he met that woman at the well in John chapter 4, he went to the root of the matter. He dealt with truth. We worship in spirit and truth. And so we're living in a day and age where we don't need to come up with new things and put all kinds of new labels and do all these type of things. We just need to take the truth of God's Word and the love and grace of God and embrace people with that. And that's simply what we were trying and attempting and endeavoring to do there in that city. And we've seen some people saved, a few people baptized. We baptized actually in the English Channel. And I was hoping the tide would be in, but it was not. It was out. And so I wish you could really see it, but we walked a long ways out from the shore. I kept walking and walking and walking, and we were so far away from the people, they couldn't even hear me speak, really. And I got so far out from the people, and I was just below my knee. I said, we're not going to go any further. I believe I can get you underwater right here. And by the way, baptism has nothing to do with salvation.
That's right, brother.
Amen.
Baptism has nothing to do with salvation.
Amen.
All right, just make sure you're with me. Checking up here for the front row here. believer's baptism there in the English Channel, baptized Tristan White and another young boy from Zimbabwe, Tanaka, one day. And I had a glorious time. The church is still going. And pray for it. West Hill Baptist Chapel. Young people are still coming to Sunday school there, hearing the gospel preached, learning the truths of God's Word. And it's a wonderful, glorious thing. You say, what are you going to do now? I have no idea. You say, well, God brought you back here. He takes you from one thing and He'll lead you to give you exactly what you're supposed to do. And if you try to get your theology from the works of God, about how you think He's going to work, you'll stay nervous. God's Word is His written revelation of Himself. We learn a lot about the nature and the sovereignty and authority and the power and omnipotence of God. Those are all of His characters and His attributes, and that's His nature. We learn a lot about Him from His names all throughout the Word of God. And that's a wonderful thing, but I know God has something specific for us, and I can say tonight that I'm in the will of God, and I'm happy in the Lord, I'm enjoying the journey, and I'm thankful for all that God is doing. You say, well, how can we help you? Maybe we'll write these three things down. Pray specifically. Pray specifically that God would use us, that God would keep, that we would stay usable, and that God would use us. My wife and I. I'm sorry, my wife is not able to be here with me tonight. She's teaching kindergarten at Lewisburg Baptist Academy. And normally she's with me quite often. But pray specifically for us. Pray for our health, our spiritual health. Pray that we grow in the Lord. Pray that we would wait patiently on the Lord. And pray that we would act obediently. Now you can pray that for yourself. God, help me to pray specifically. God, help me to wait patiently. God, help me to act obediently. I think those three truths, I believe we could preach it tonight. That's not the message, but I believe that would help all of us. Wait on the Lord, I say. Wait. That's a hard thing to do. You know what? Something harder than that is wishing that you would have waited. When you get ahead of God, it's not a very beautiful thing. A few minutes ago, I ate with a family just down the road here. In 2004, they sponsored me as a writer, helped along. Their Sam Pierce, his daughter's here tonight. She's visiting Nicole, and they were helping me out racing, and they did a lot, invested in motocross in a big way. In 2004, I got ahead of God. I came to Rocky Mount, Virginia, to spend a week of riding. I broke my wrist in Texas. I told my dad, I said, I'm done racing. God has a different plan for my life. He has something else for me. I don't know what it is. I quit school when I was 14 years old. I couldn't even quote the ABCs when I was 17 years old. Couldn't do it. I thought, what in the world am I going to do? What's God want me to do? And so I told him, I'm done racing. God has something else. And I got my cast off. I broke my wrist in Texas, told him I was done, but I got my cast off and I still had the motorcycle still there and had an open door to go to Rocky Mountain and spend a week there riding. And so I went over there. I said, I'm going to give it another chance. I'm going to go ride again. This is something that I love, I enjoy. I have a desire and ambition to race a motorcycle. And I spent Monday through Friday in Rocky Mount, came back to West Virginia, regeared, regrouped, and went to Athens, Ohio, and fell over in a corner. I mean, I was barely moving at all. I fell over in a corner and tore my ACL. And I've had two surgeries on that, and about 25 grand later, I look back on that. I got ahead of God. And when I got ahead of God, this is what God had to do to get my attention. Mm. He had to touch my health to get a hold of my heart.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
That's sad. Mm. As we come into the message here tonight, I want to ask you this question. What is the love of God doing in your life right now? The love of God. What is the love of God doing in your life right now? I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. I think there's very persuasive power in the love, the mercy, and the grace of God. And we're going to get to it. We're going to try to draw a verdict here tonight. And you say, well, you're not going to get me to come to a verdict or make a choice or decision tonight. Well, if you feel that way, you've already made your decision.
That's right.
I hope you come here tonight wanting God to speak to you. This is the home crowd here tonight. Mm-hmm. I'm thankful. I'm privileged to speak to you tonight. Amen. I thank God for it. I'm asking God to speak to us specifically. We're going to get going in a moment, so just strap your seatbelt on. We're going to get there. But I want to ask you this question. What is the love of God doing in your life right now? Mm. If you had to come up here tonight and give a testimony, this is what the love of God means to me. This is what the love of God is doing in my life right now. I'm not necessarily talking about the Holy Spirit of God, the Word of God, or what Christ is doing in your life, or what God is convicting you and convincing you about. I'm talking about the love of God. What is the love of God doing? We're going to look here in a very familiar verse, John chapter 3, verse number 16 tonight. Hope you have your Bibles there. John chapter 3 and verse number 16. Very familiar verse. The Bible says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Very familiar verse. I think many of you could well know, right, recite the context of this passage. Nicodemus comes to the Lord Jesus. He comes to Him by night. He's a very curious man. I'm not a big fan of the nighttime. When I was these young people's age and I'd go out at night, I'd get very scared. In fact, when I go outside now, sometimes I still get a little bit scared. I'll pack the Glock on my hip and I'm out in the middle of the cow field. What's a cow going to do to me? But I get a little bit nervous. There's some very interesting things that happen on night and nighttime. You study the night passages through Scripture and I think you'll find something very interesting if you follow that through from Genesis to Revelation. But this man comes to the Lord Jesus by night. He was a curious man. And when he comes to the Lord Jesus, Jesus preaches to him or teaches it to him about the necessity of regeneration, be born again. He talks to him about the new birth. Nicodemus was not only a curious man, but he was a confident man. He told the Lord Jesus, he said, "We know that thou art a teacher come from God." He was a confident man. He was a Pharisee. He would have been trained in lots of different things and supposedly have known his Bible. He should have known that Jesus Christ was not only pictured, but he was prophesied and preached about all through the Old Testament. And the fullness of time, Galatians 4:4, God sent forth His Son. And here He is. And he's a curious man, but he's also a confident man. And I believe through this teaching of the Word of God here, we find in John chapter 3, he was a converted man. Jesus brings him here to verse number 14, and he says to Pharisee, or to Nicodemus, this Pharisee, he says to this man, "And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up." He says he recalls to him a very familiar passage that he would have known about from the Old Testament, talking about Moses when he raised that serpent and they had to look to that serpent there to live, to look and live. The Bible says in Isaiah 45 and verse number 22, "Look unto me and be saved. I am God and there is none else." Looking to the Lord Jesus Christ in faith. There's life in a look. We find that in the Old Testament. We find it in the New Testament. It's a look of faith. And by the way, faith is not a one-time event. It's a way of life.
Amen, brother.
That's right.
You see, we as Bible-believing Christians, we know so much about salvation. We can go back to a point in time of our life where we say, we called upon the Lord Jesus Christ to forgive us of our sins and give us a home in eternity with Him. We can recite that. We know that. But how much do we really know about surrender, about sacrifice, about obedience, about following the Lord throughout the rest of our life? So faith is not a one-time event, looking to the Lord Jesus Christ just simply for salvation, but it's a way of life. See, there was a young boy in England headed home one snowy afternoon. It was very cold, and he was wandering his way home, and I believe God was dealing with him, convicting him of his need of a Savior. And he come by an old Methodist chapel. He walked in the back door and he sat down, and the pastor of the church or the preacher that might have been riding by on horse, it wasn't even not even a God-called preacher that was preaching there that night.
That's right.
It was a layman.
That's right.
Never underestimate anybody.
Amen.
Be optimistic.
That's right.
Be optimistic until somebody gives you a reason not to be optimistic. And when they give you a reason not to be optimistic, still have grace with that person.
Amen.
This young man slipped in the back and he sat down. He heard this layman up preaching. His text was Isaiah 45 and verse number 22.
Right.
The young man was converted that night.
That's right.
You know who that man was?
Spurgeon.
Mr. Spurgeon.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's so wonderful.
Amen.
That people can preach from the Old Testament and be saved.
Amen.
Don't neglect those Old Testament scriptures. We live in a day and age where some people just want to say, oh, it's just New Testament, New Testament, New Testament. Look, there's so many gospel gems in that Old Testament. You heard about one last night from Genesis chapter 22. Young man was saved. You know, but Spurgeon didn't stop at salvation. What if he said, whoa, I've got my helmet of salvation on. I'm saved. I'm going to heaven. I'm born again, blood washed, blood bought, back from the slave market of sin. I'm here. I'm glorified, sanctified. I'm in Christ. I'm a new creature. And said, I'm just going to warm a pew occasionally. No, he didn't stop at that. He continued looking to the Lord Jesus Christ. So Jesus calls to Nicodemus on this. He says, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. How was he lifted up? He hung between heaven and earth. Verse number 15, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. I believe the hooks were really starting to dig in and to him. The conviction was setting in. And he was really understanding what Jesus Christ had come to do. And then he comes to verse number 16. And we understand they didn't have chapters and verse divisions in that point in time. But he says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Now in my Bible, I have 25 words in verse number 16. Anytime you have an odd number of words in a sentence or a thought or an expression, you have a middle word. The first 12 goes like this. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten. That's God's part. He gave. The last 12 goes like this. That whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. Church, tell me which word I left out. So the first 12 is God's part. He gave. He gave His only begotten Son, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God that was prophesied and preached and pictured in the Old Testament. And here He is. That was God's part, giving His Son. The last 12 is man's part, believing on Jesus Christ. But the Son is found right in the middle, and He is the one that brings God and man together. I believe in Scriptures He's also called the mediator, the go-between. He's our advocate. It's here it is, Jesus Christ. the way, the truth, and life. No man cometh unto the Father but by Him. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved, as in the Lord Jesus Christ. I find this here in verse number 16. For God so loved. God's love gives. God's love gave His only begotten Son. God's love invites whosoever, anybody. God's love points out all four points of the compass, to the north, to the east, to the south, to the west. Don't matter who you are, where you're from, what you've done, God's grace is all sufficient.
Amen.
God's blood can cover any sin. You're here tonight, you've lied, you've cheated, you've stolen. You've been involved in immorality and idolatry. Look, we've got kids raising kids. We've got lots of people that are struggling. They're trying to move from hurt and hate to hope and help. And they're looking all around the world. But here it is, we that have the truth, we're sitting on it. We know the love of God. The love of God has worked in our life. And they're missing it because we're so silent. We're so satisfied with the status quo. Look, God's love gave, it invites, and it saves. Whosoever believes in Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. It saves. God's love saves. You see the supreme giver in this verse, which is God. You see the supreme gift in this verse, which is Jesus Christ. For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. He's the supreme gift. You see the polar opposites of eternity in this verse. Perish. If you don't believe on the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation, you perish, you waste away, you die. And then you have the second death, you're cast in the lake of fire, the weeping and gnashing of teeth for all of eternity, separated from the love of God. There's a great gulf fixed between. You know why I believe hell or the lake of fire is such a terrible place? Because there's no love there.
That's right, brother.
There's no grace there.
Yeah,
you see, every unbelieving person alive on this terrestrial ball that's spinning around the sun in this atmosphere, they are experiencing the love of God. If they're not saved, this is the only enjoyment, the only fun and thrills and all the fascinations of life that they'll ever experience. I do not wish hell on my worst enemy. By the way, the enemy's not the White House. It's not Republicans. It's not Democrats. It's not independents. It's not homosexuals.
That's right.
By the way, there's no such thing as a transgender. It's impossible to change your gender.
Amen.
If you refer to them as a transgender, you're giving them a platform. There's no such thing as a transgender. It's impossible. Male and female. Be careful what you listen to. Be careful what you repeat. Think about it. Homosexuals, the people that are confused about their state. Look, they're not the enemy. The Muslims are not the enemy. They're radical. They hate me. They want to kill us, infidels. They want to bomb us. They want to blow us up. They want to fly airplanes into this. They want to mow us down with AKs and they want to burn our flag. They hate us, Americans. Look, they're not the enemy. Look, there was people that wanted to stone Jesus. Did He consider them His enemy? Judas sold Him out for 30 pieces of silver. Judas kissed the door of heaven, but sold out for 30 pieces of silver that he would throw out on the ground and go out into a field and hang himself.
Wow.
Jesus never referred to him as an enemy. The chief priests, the rulers, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, He never referred to them as an enemy. Bless them that persecute you and despitefully use you. You say, who's the enemy? Who are the opposing forces? Look, when you stand up, you wake up in the morning, and you walk to a mirror, and you look in that mirror, you're looking at an enemy. It's this flesh. You say, when you got saved, your soul was saved. Spirit, you're saved. You're born again. But look, you still have this flesh nature. The flesh and the spirit, they war against one another. There's a civil war going on in your life each and every day. Two forces beat within my breast. The one is foul, the other is blessed. The one I love, the other I hate. The one I feed will dominate. The arch enemy of Christianity, your home, your family, your children, the devil, the demons of hell. Look, and we are not to get in a conversation with the devil. We're not to stand at the door of our house or the door of this church and get into conversation. He's greater than you. He's not greater than Jesus. You get in a conversation with the devil. Look what happened to Eve. She lived in a perfect environment. It was sinless. We live in a sin-cursed world. How do you think you're going to stand? Look, we're not to fight the devil, but we're to shoot the Word of God to him. We're to submit ourselves unto God, draw nigh to Him, resist the devil, and he will what?
Flee.
I don't even know how I've gotten down this road, but look, understand who the enemy is. When the love of God begins to work in our heart, our position and our disposition will change with the people who we think are the enemy. The opposition. God's love gives, invites, and saves. I want to come closer to the message. Let's look in 1 John chapter number 4 for a moment. Understand what time it is. I hope you're sticking along with me. We'll be done in just a moment. 1 John chapter number 4. 1 John chapter number 4. Thinking more here, just a little bit about the love of God. Verse number 9 of 1 John chapter number 4. The Bible says, "In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent His only begotten Son into the world that we might live through Him." Notice verse number 10. "Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins." Now, I'm a hillbilly. That's a big word for me, propitiation. That's a big word. Pastor Ratliff and I came across a word today that I can't even pronounce it right now. I couldn't even spell it if my life depended on it. I said, I have a little rule. If I can't spell it, then I can't use it. This is a big word here, propitiation. What does that mean? What does it look like? What is that? Well, it's simply, it's kind of like this. Say I've went over here to this dealership. It's a pretty nice dealership. They have a really nice, beautiful, fancy, yellow-looking car on the inside of it. I would say there's probably a luxury tax on that car. Not just a regular standard tax, but there's probably a luxury tax on that car. I pay lots of money for it. I'm well over $100,000. I walk in, I pay cash for it. I don't have that kind of money. I walk out of there and I drive it over here to Singing Hills Road and I pull it in the parking lot. I've just bought it. I haven't put insurance, anything on it yet. I pull it in over here and Pastor Ratliff pulls in the parking lot. And he's like, "Wow, I've been looking after that thing a few weeks that I've been driving by it, and wow, now it's in my parking lot." He says, can I take it for a drive? I say, "Oh yeah, take it for a ride." In fact, it don't even have a key. It just has one of the buttons you push. Vroom, fires up. He gets inside of it, shuts the door, hits the button, revs the RPMs up. And he's like, "Wow, this is nice. This ain't my Chevy Cobalt. Yeah. This thing's got ponies under the hood." Yeah. He pops it into gear and peels the wheels, smokes the tires, and I'm thinking, "Oh my." Out of the parking lot he goes. And I'm waiting. I'm meandering around the parking lot. He's gone 5, 10, 15 minutes. I'm like, "Man, what the world? Where's he gone?" About 45 minutes later, I hear a diesel engine truck coming. I'm like, "That's not my car." I see it pop around the corner here by the church, and it's a tow truck with a nice, brand new, beat up, mangled, yellow Mercedes. The bumper's off, the tires are flat, the windshield's gone. It's all smashed in, the driver's side door's caved in, and I'm like, "What in the world happened?" He gets out and he says, "I'm sorry. It's destroyed. I'm really sorry, it's destroyed." I say, well, look, I didn't have any insurance on it. There was no coverage. And then our brother here, he pulls in the parking lot. You got to tell me your name again.
David.
All right. I was afraid to say David, but David pulls in and he says, man, what's going on here? What happened? And I explained the situation. And I said, man, my car's destroyed. That's no longer in its original condition. I don't have any insurance. I can't pay for it. I can't fix it. It's beyond my ability to take care of it. And Mr. David said, oh, don't worry about it. He pulls out his wallet. Yeah. He says, don't worry about it. Have you met Mr. Visa? He says, I'll take care of it. Look, Mr. David says, it's covered in full. It's paid in full. He said, I'll take it from this destroyed condition and I'll restore it. It's paid in full. That's kind of what that word has the idea of.
Right.
Propitiation. You see, by one Adam we were destroyed.
That's right.
By the second Adam we were restored.
That's right.
Paid in full. Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but He washed it white as snow.
Amen.
Oh, the love of God is something wonderful. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be a propitiation for our sins. Verse number 11, beloved, if God so loved us, we ought to also love one another. Look also in verse number 16, and we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. This is the revelation of God's love. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us. He loved us first. The Bible says here clearly that God is love. Not that He was love or He will be love. It is His very nature that He is love.
That's right.
That's the revelation. But we also see the response to God's love here in this passage. Verse number 19, the Bible says we love Him because He first loved us.
Amen.
See, God's previous in all things. God come looking for Adam. Adam didn't come looking for God.
That's right.
God come looking for him. He come to seek and to save that which is lost. And God's previous in all matters. He's before our thoughts. He's before our actions. He's before our deeds. He's before any transaction that we ever make or think or do here on this earth. God is always previous. The revelation of God's love. He is love. But if we love God at all, it's because He loved us. That's a response to His love. So I ask you this question. What is the love of God doing in your life? Herein is love. This is love. Not that we love God, but that He loved us. There's another verse very akin to that. Romans 5, verse number 8. But God commendeth or demonstrated or approved His love for us in that while we were yet sinners, in a hatred, in a rebellion, with a closed, clenched fist in the face of God, in our pride, our rebellion, our hate towards Him, He loved us. Romans 5, 8 tells us. While we were in that state, that condition, God still loved us. Can you love somebody that's at war against you? Some of you are having a hard time loving your neighbor. Some of you are having a very difficult time at loving a coworker. Some of you are having an extremely difficult time at loving a family member. And I would say there'd be a number here tonight that's having a very difficult time loving someone in the church family.
Yeah.
Look, we're not going to impress an unbelieving world with a fancy church building, clean carpet, well-lit building, a perfect-sounding choir, an eloquent pastor. We're not going to impress an unbelieving world that way. How are we going to impress them? With our love for God and our love for one another. So here comes the message. We're not going to turn to all these passages. I want you to think about Jonah for just a moment. He was a patriot for his country. You know the story well, four chapters. God calls for Jonah to arise and go to Nineveh and preach that that city is, their sin has come up before me. It's a wicked place. But he's a real patriot for his country, for Israel. The Assyrians, the Ninevites, and the Israelites, they hated one another. They despised one another. The Assyrians were wicked people. They learned how to lay a body out on a table and fillet the flesh off of a human being and keep them alive. That's how wicked and vile they were. And God says, Jonah, I want you to go to them and preach. Pretty wild. He rebels. He gets on a boat and goes the exact opposite direction. By the way, we all have a Nineveh. We all have a Tarshish. Which way are you headed tonight?
That's good, brother.
He gets going the exact opposite way. He finds a boat. He pays the fare thereof to get on it to go. God throws him overboard. He gets swallowed by a great fish. He repents in chapter number 2. I want you to think about that picture for just a moment. Here is Jonah inside of a fish. I believe it. I believe that in the verbal plenary inspiration of the Word of God, I believe this event happened. He's inside of this whale, this great fish. I've never been inside of a fish. I've skinned a few deer. I've never been inside of a deer before, but I can just, I've filleted the deer open before, and I think, oh, this is nasty. It stinks. This is weird. It's strange. But imagine for a moment you yourself inside of a fish. It's dark. It's dungeon-like. It's very damp. You're locked in. It stinks. It smells nasty. It's horrible. It's a mingy-making place. He's locked in. He's in the pains and chains. That's what he's in chapter number 2. He repents. He says, salvation is of the Lord. And the thing vomits him out. He hits the dry ground. He runs to Nineveh. He preaches. And from the top of the chief of the totem pole to the lowest there, repents towards God. A great mighty revival takes place. But then in chapter number 4, you find Jonah pouting. He's outside of the city of Nineveh. He's angry with God. He's displeased with the grace and the mercy of God. He says, I know when I was in my country that thou art a gracious and merciful God. He's sitting out on that east side of the city, I believe the Bible says, I think. He's sitting there, and God sends a vehement east wind. Essentially, it was an unbearable heat. Unbearable. So here it is, Jonah chapter 2, he's in bondage. He's locked in. Chapter 4, God sends something else, an unbearable heat. I believe God was giving him a picture and a reminder of what the unbelievers are living in and what they are headed for. You see, he's inside that well. He can't get out on his own. He's in bondage. He's in those chains. And the only way he's going to get out is by that fish opening up. And God swallowed him in and God could take him out. And chapter 4, he's getting that unbearable heat. He was sending them a reminder. God was sending him a reminder of what they're headed for. That lake of fire. That Christless eternity. And God says something very interesting in the closing verses. Should not I have compassion on this city of 60,000 people and much cattle? What is the love of God doing in your life? First of all, it should be crowding out. Get this. It should be crowding out of the pride and ugliness in our life. Jonah wanted to live for himself. He was no doubt a patriot for his country. I thank God for patriotic people. But whatever God has called you to trumps patriotism.
Amen. Amen, brother.
Last night, I know we got the home crowd here tonight. Last night, there was more shouts, hoots, hollers, and amens when somebody was talking about something political here last night.
Right.
But there was some really good stuff that was preached here last night.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a little bit quieter.
That's right, brother.
Look, the love of God should be crowding out some things in our life.
Amen.
Then we come to John chapter 21. we find a rebellious, running disciple of the Lord, the apostle. Before Jesus is crucified on Golgotha, he denies the Lord 3 times, Peter does. I don't know him. I'm not one of his. I'm not a follower. I'm not a disciple. I don't know who he is. He even throws a cussing fit. In John chapter 21, he says to 6 other men, he says, I go a fishing, maybe 7. He says, I go a fishing, I'm done. I'm throwing in the towel, I'm going for a recreational trip. I'm done with this religious thing, I'm going fishing. And the other disciples follow him. Jesus shows up. Isn't it wonderful when Jesus shows up?
Amen.
Jesus shows up. He says, cast the net on the other side. For whatever reason, Peter jumps in the water. He's naked, jumps in the water. They come to shore with a great load of fish, and John says, look, Peter, he's wanting to talk to you. He wants you. And Jesus asks him 3 questions. Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Yes, you know I love you, Lord. You know I love you. He replies, hey, feed my sheep, feed my lambs. Look, it's a love issue. And then we get down just a little bit further in that passage. Peter's still not loving Jesus. He professes to love Jesus those 3 times. But he's still worried about another disciple, John the Beloved. He said, Peter says to Jesus, what about him? What about him? And Jesus says, what is that to thee? One of these days I'm going to preach a message. What's it to you? He says to him, what is it to thee? Not only is the love of God trying to crowd out some things in our life, but the love of God should be crippling our own strength. Peter, no doubt, was a strong man, strong-willed man. Somebody may say he's a self-made man. I live in the country, lots of farmers. They're red, white, and blue kind of people. Their hair's turning white, their neck's red, and their collar's blue.
Yeah, there you go.
And some people look at him and say, that's a self-made man. He's farmed since he's been 5 years old. He's a tough man. The love of God can cripple any man. Think about the Apostle Paul. Before he got saved, a raging bull, Saul of Tarsus, locking people up. God stopped him in his tracks. He went from a persecutor to a preacher. He went from a blasphemer to a blessing. Look, the love of God should crowd, it should cripple. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 14, the love of God should constrain.
Amen.
God's love is so preeminent, it's so sovereign, it's so supreme. It constrains me, it compels me, it urges me to live the Christian life and become the Christian God saved me to be.
Amen.
The love of God should constrain. But you're restraining. I'm restraining the Lord, His love. The Apostle Paul said that. He said, the love of God constraineth. We restrain it. We get fearful. We get nervous. We hide behind a hymn book, an invitation. We hide behind all kinds of things in life. I don't want this person to find out I'm a Christian. I can't witness to them. I can't tell them my testimony. I can't tell them about the love of God. I can't take a stand. I can be contentious, but I can't contend for the faith. Look, the love of God should constrain us, compel us, to urge us, to move us forward, to become the Christian God saved us to be. The Christian life is all about pursuing after Jesus Christ, being like Him. Nowhere in Scripture does God tell us to be God. Nowhere. Only in Scripture do we find that we are to conform to the image of God's Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. The devil says, be like God. That's what the devil told Eve in the garden. Ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Wait a moment, Eve. You live in a perfect world, a perfect environment. All you know is good. You're not going to become a god. You're not going to know all this. You live in a perfect world. Wait a minute, Eve. Don't do it. She doesn't. The devil says, be God. Be the king. Be the ruler. Be the chief. Be the captain. Have all eyes on me. Let me run for the prize. Let me strive for my ambitious things in life. Some of you don't want to be constrained for nothing. The moment that you let loose of those restraining reins in life and said, Lord, here I am, take my life, let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. God's love will go to work in your heart, your home, your life, your family, your workplace, this church, in an amazing way. And you'll look back and think, how foolish did I live for so many years in restraint? The love of God should crowd, cripple, constrain. And lastly, Revelation chapter 3, it should crush. It should crush. Maybe it's Revelation chapter 2. The church of Ephesus, you can look it up. I'm sorry, I apologize. Church of Ephesus, they are toiling. I'll turn there. Revelation chapter 2. Verse number 2, he says, I know thy works. He's the Lord speaking to the church of Ephesus. He says, I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, how thou canst not bear them which are evil. We have a hard time bearing them which are evil. And thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars. And hast borne and hast had patience for my name's sake, hast labored and not fainted. You say, well, that sounds pretty good. Man, this church is toiling. They're serving. They're endeavoring. They're everlastingly at it, night and day. They're after it. But Jesus says, God says, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. That's what he says to this church of Ephesus. There's no substitute for loving God.
Amen.
You say, I'm serving, I'm working. There's no substitute for loving God. Absolutely not. You see, we're all on the same playing field. There's some things that we can excuse. Look at me now. There's some things we can excuse. A lack of education, we can excuse that. Not everyone was privileged or had the ability to get the same education. I would say there's probably 10 different schools, elementary schools represented here tonight. They could be 10 different elementary, middle, high schools, colleges. Not everyone's had the same opportunity to be educated the same way. We can excuse a lack of education. We can excuse the lack of physical ability. There's people here tonight that can't run as fast as others. There's people here that can't run as long as others. There's people here stronger than others. There's people here that's weak. There's people here that have chemical imbalances and different things and lots of different things. We can excuse the lack of physical ability. But there's one thing we can never excuse in the ministry for anybody. You can never excuse a lack of love for God.
Amen.
This was a serving church. They were everlastingly at it. They were steadfast, unmovable, always abounding. But Jesus says, look, nevertheless, you're doing all these things, but I have somewhat against thee. You have left your first love. If you've left your love for the Lord Jesus, then you're loving something else. And you need to allow God to crush that love for whatever else it is. The love of God should crowd, cripple, constrain, and crush. Crush whatever it is that you love more than God.
Amen.
Absolutely. God set the standard in Matthew chapter 22. A lawyer comes up, he shows up and says, what's the greatest commandment? He thought he was going to catch Jesus, and Jesus set the standard. He said, to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy might. Mind in the New Testament, might in the Old Testament, he says. Love God supremely. So I ask you tonight, what is the love of God doing in your life? You see these pictures through. We could see a lot more pictures throughout the Bible. Just a few men that the Lord pressed upon my heart. Jonah. John, or Peter, the book of John. Paul says, the love of Christ constraineth me. This church here, look, from an individual to a preacher, a pastor, a church planter, to a church. I believe that encompasses us all here this evening. individuals, preachers, there's some other preachers here I imagine tonight, a church, a body. Look, we need to love God supremely. It will radically change your home, your marriage, your relationship with your children, the workplace. It'll change this church. I thank God that I'm here tonight. There's new faces. It's been at least 3 years since I've been here. There's new faces here. That's a wonderful thing.
Amen.
If we start loving God like we ought to, and how God has said it, and we allow God to crush, cripple, crowd, and constrain us, a lot more is going to be done. But doing more is not the goal.
Right.
The goal is God, loving Him. So tonight, what is it in your life that has your affection, your love, your appetite? What is it? I'm not here to have a confessional booth. I'm not here to beat you up. I'm not here to rake you over coals by any means. The Holy Spirit can do a much better job than that. I can. Look, but this encourages me. God loves me when I don't love Him. You ever think about that? God is faithful to me when I'm not faithful to Him. God loves us unconditionally. What is it? Every head bowed, every eye closed tonight.